What is up, guys, gals, and all you awesome, awesomeens and gamers of different shapes and sizes? It is me, Josh, aka Noir Proxy, bringing you some Gears of War 4 on the Xbox One. I nearly said PlayStation 4 there. I'm just so used to saying it because obviously I cover a lot more games on the PlayStation 4 compared to the Xbox One. But as you know, like, originally I was doing a Let's Play of Gears of War 4 on the Xbox One for you, and something kind of happened. I ended up playing through the campaign, which was, it was alright, you know, it wasn't bad from what I've played so far. I am recording it all for review. I also apologize for the lateness of a lot of reviews. As you know, I like to make sure that I've played every little single detail compared to a lot of other media sites that try and rush them out before embargo. I like to take time with games, and so I'm doing that with a lot of games at the moment. I'm pretty much reviewing like at least 8 games still. Even doing like Deus Ex, Mankind Divided, and XCOM 2 and things. As you know, I'm actually, you know, trying to take my time with a lot of these. But with Gears of War 4, I feel like it won't take that long because the actual content that was provided is very, very short. Now, I have actually cancelled the Let's Play. I've ended up cancelling the Let's Play of Gears of War 4 because, sadly, it's actually not that good. It's very, very disappointing, and this is coming from somebody that was a mega fan of Gears of War originally on Xbox 360. It was the reason why I bought an Xbox 360. Like, Gears of War 1 was so awesome to me back in the day. I played through it so many times that now I just can't play the first game because I'm sick of it. Because I played it so many times, like the campaign, the multiplayer, and like, seeing the evolution of the series has been very, very saddening to me. Because I really like Gears of War 1. Gears of War 1 was really, really good. And then they brought Gears of War 2 out, which for some reason as well I find to be slightly uncomfortable when it comes to playing it. I feel like it's because it went like in an odd direction, like a very stale direction, like they tried to play it a little too safe. Like, there wasn't really much added onto it apart from like the horde mode, and they didn't really expand on many things with Gears of War 2. Like, they just tried to like add scale. It's kind of like battling Uncharted 2 in a sense, and that was kind of like the wrong idea maybe. But anyway, there was then Gears of War 3, and Gears of War 3 was really good, probably my favorite of all the Gears of War games. And I was hoping that it would probably like only escalate. You know, they added in the Silverback, which is a really cool idea, having like robots in Gears of War, but like steampunky, like mashed together kind of things. That was something that I really have always liked about Gears of War, is this whole thing where everything kind of feels clammed together because they're trying to survive from a lack of actual being able to progress in their own kind of like human like society, because of obviously the locust and obviously because of like civil infighting and stuff. Like, I paid attention to the Gears of War lore and things, but it's just like a shame that they kind of didn't like take it even further after Gears of War 3. They obviously did Judgment, which was a prequel, and now they've done Gears of War 4, which is kind of like a forced sequel in a sense, to the same level. Did you see those two little bits of meat on the stairs there, like going back and forth? That was weird. But it's kind of a shame to see them kind of like force Gears of War 4 out just because kind of like Halo 5. Like, Halo 5 shouldn't have existed in a sense. Like, Halo 4 felt like a very good way to end it in a way. And then with Halo 5 Guardians, it was, I don't know, like, when me and Alexis played all the way through it, there was just this like really odd feeling of they were just trying to start it again. And so Gears of War 4 has that feeling throughout the whole thing. It feels like they're kind of like trying to cater to people that like the old Gears of War, with say having Marcus Fenix in it and having a few little cameos here and there. But the actual kind of like meat of it feels like they're trying to start it all again. And it even feels like that in the content, which is kind of saddening, because you've got the campaign, and as you know from like Gears of War campaigns, a lot of the times they're really good. Like, a lot of people actually buy Gears of War for the campaign, not the multiplayer. It's only recently that people have gone a little bit nuts with the multiplayer, because obviously Gears of War 4 is aimed at multiplayer. But people originally bought Gears of War because of the story. Like, it was quite a cool story, especially when playing couch co-op with your friends. Everyone used to love playing Gears of War couch co-op. The split screen was one of the main features of it. And so it's really sad. It's really, really sad to see them shorten the campaign and make it this small package, which feels like an introduction package with a few little unique things in it, like the firestorm, and there is like a mech scene in it and stuff as well. But it really doesn't kind of like expand on it. Like, as you know, I was already like, was it like 5 parts into my Let's Play, and I was already in chapter 3 of 5. That is how kind of like quick the campaign is, and it's kind of weird that it does that, because when you play it, you can feel like the idea of something good coming out of it, but the character development is so poorly done. Why did that bullet go right for that guy's head? That was kind of weird. But the campaign itself is so poorly written in the sense of its character development. Like, you've got these three brand new, like, protagonists, and JD, who is the main character, gets, like, pretty much no character development apart from being, like, the son of Marcus Fenix. And then you have, like, Kat, who we're playing as right now, or Kate. Is it Kate or is it Kat? This is the thing, you have the initial kind of, like, injection of a potentially really cool set of characters. And then you've got the other guy, the third guy. I don't even remember who that guy is. He couldn't have even been there. He's not even, like, a playable co-op character. He's just there, you know, as being, like, the third dude in the party. But, like, throughout all of it, all I thought to myself was, Kat, Kay, this gal here, was easily the most interesting person in the entire game, and you don't even get to play as her unless you are the co-op player. And that was so saddening, because she is really cool, she's really awesome, and it would have been fantastic to have seen a female protagonist step forth into the Gears of War universe, because obviously we've had female characters in the game, we've had some really cool, like, characters, like, saying, again, Gears of War 2 and Gears of War 3, but they were always very side characterish, kind of like Cole and Baird, you know, or even Carmine. And so seeing these characters not get fully fleshed out, especially Kate, especially Kat, I can't remember what, I'm gonna call her Kate because I think her name is Kate, but she's a really awesome character. She's a really awesomely designed character too. I love the beanie, I love how she's wearing her shirt around her waist, and she's also wearing Anya's battle armor, as we know from the story, and she's really cool to play as. Like, I really appreciate her, and I really appreciate her kind of, like, place in the future of the series, but there needed to be more of her. There needed to be more of these main characters, and you don't get much of those main characters. They're kind of just there. They're kind of just experiencing things, and you're kind of, like, put in a place where you're supposed to kind of acknowledge them as if they've been there the entire time, which seems like a very weird thing to do, don't you think? I think it's personally, like, a very weird thing to do. And so, what they've ended up doing is, they've ended up putting more focus on the multiplayer. They put more focus on the Horde mode, but with doing that, and this is where complaints kind of, like, well, complaints, I'm supposed to say, not complaints, complaining and complaints arise even more, is that the multiplayer and even the Horde mode are actually lacking in content compared to what the original games presented. Like, Gears of War 3 had a ton of content. Like, why is there more of those meat things everywhere? They're, like, flopping all over the place. Look at them rocking back and forth on the floor. What's that about? I'm trying to shoot this monster in the backside for some reason, but maybe it just gets attention, because I want some love. But I realized that the multiplayer, which is so oddly unbalanced, I'm just going to say that right now, like, I can use a Nasher, as you can see here, but the game has become so Nasher-centric that even the forums, the community, is starting to get really agitated with it. Like, you can use lances and all the other guns in the game, but the Nasher is so powerful at mid-range to close range that it feels like the people who, from the Coalition, who are now the developers of Gears of War, that ended up, you know, taking on the title, so that they were maybe the Nasher fans of the previous games. You know, they were the ones that were going to the Nasher and making it so Nasher-centric in the original titles as well, that it feels like it's very forced into that you use the Nasher way too much. Even in the campaign, the Nasher is kind of like that, like, it's the shotgun, as you can see here, we're using the Nasher. But it's to that point where it even feels like it's supposed to be the staple gun instead of the Lancer. Like, again, you can use a Lancer in the multiplayer, but it's so difficult to even utilize the Lancer in the multiplayer that there's sometimes not much point, because it's so weak. Like, you can stay at a range and you can try and shoot people, but there is just no point using it half the time. And that's really depressing, because I really love the Lancer. It is the staple gun, the poster child of Gears of War, yet it's useless. It just seems weird. Obviously, you can chainsaw people, but they hear you coming a mile away, and obviously if they shoot you once, you drop the Lancer's, like, chainsaw ability and stuff, and so it's so weird that they haven't kind of, like, tried to evolve the Lancer into being an actual kind of go-to weapon. You start with it, but you instantly replace it once you get a different gun, which is, yeah, or you go to the Nasher. Again, you go to the Nasher. And so here's another thing. So you may notice right here that we're using the Fabricator. So the Fabricator in Gears of War's Horde mode, which they call Horde 3.0, is basically what I would say is, like, a step back. So the Fabricator allows you to create different items for defense and also buy weapons. So you say if you didn't like the loadout that you're given, you can actually buy weapons from the Fabricator, and you can also buy turrets, you can buy a sentry gun, and the barbed wire. But the unusual thing is that they've actually put less content than in Gears of War 3. In Gears of War 3, you actually had more stuff in the Horde 2.0 than you actually do in the Horde 3.0, which is in Gears of War 4. So you don't have the Silverback anymore. And I know a few people didn't really like the silverback because they thought it was too powerful, but it was really useful for boss levels. It was really useful for boss levels. I really liked having that sentry mode when it was in the silverback, which was pretty much the mech. You had a mech in the survival mode, which was awesome, so I really, really liked that. But they've taken that out. They've also taken a bunch of other kind of little, like, defensive options as well in the Horde 3.0. They've also put less enemies in it as well. Like, obviously, they've had to remove the locusts because the locusts don't really exist in the... I'm not going to spoil anything, but the locusts don't really exist that well in Gears of War 4's universe now. And so that means that they've had to put even... like more kind of like variants into the enemy types. So what you've got is you've got the robots, which are called, they call like BDs or something. So you've got the robots, which I hated at the start of the campaign. They're really annoying, they're really boring. As you see, they just walk around and you just pop them in the head and they're dead. And so you have those, and you have a few little bits of swarm, and you have the odd boss or such. And the funny thing is that in Gears of War 3, you had a variety of different bosses. Like, you had a Brumac, you had the Reavers, you had a few other things as well. And you had a nice combination as well of, like, heavy units and the smaller units and things. But in this, all they've done is kind of, like, recycle a lot of the enemies and then kind of put different character models onto them, which has become their different variants. So, like, these here are kind of like standard locust soldiers, but you also have the swarm soldiers, which are pretty much standard locust grunts too. And then you have the heavier kind of, like, you know, the guy who would like hold the mulcher and the boomer and stuff. You have a robot version that just has a giant rocket launcher or shotgun, and then you have the swarm version, which is pretty much just a remodeled one of the big guy, or the one, and you don't, the funny thing is you don't have the ones holding the machetes anymore. You don't have the, like, the one with the shield, you don't have the one with the actual sword, and so there's actually less than the actual con that's provided. So what makes me wonder is, where is the 3.0 in the Horde mode? You know, like, it just seems very saddening, because the first thing I did was jump into the Horde mode. This is my first Horde mode match when I bought this game on launch, and I was shocked. I was so shocked at how little there was to offer. And then what they've done, and this is something that has become very, very popular in Gears of War, well, not Gears of War, I guess, but like Gears of War now as like a thing, and also say like Call of Duty and Overwatch and Team Fortress and Counter-Strike, you know, basically anything that's got a multiplayer component to it, everything has got very, very like stuck to this now, is this whole thing of DLC. Now, we saw this in Gears of War's original kind of like Judgment and stuff, but like a little bit, it was kind of like pandering a little bit to it. But now in Gears of War 4, what they've ended up doing is they've ended up focusing on a more grind system. So Judgment had a grind system, but this has a bigger grind system. So now what you have is, instead of having the ability to unlock brand new characters for multiplayer and Horde, you have to buy booster packs. So we've seen this in Halo 5 as well. If you want to unlock anything in Halo 5, you need to buy the booster packs, which you can either get with in-game cash or you can get with microtransactions with your actual money. Now, with that, the actual grind requirements of getting half of these characters is insanely stupid. So, like, if you want any, like, a brand new character, like armor and stuff, you obviously have luck of the dice, but instead of actually making it so then, say, you kind of, like, get increased chance of unlocking something that you really, really want after you found something that you don't want, like, say you wanted, like, Marcus Fenix. Like, now, this is the thing. So, Marcus Fenix in his, like, full-on COG armor is a legendary card. So, this is the thing. They've done it all in, like, card packs and stuff, as I just said, with booster packs and things. So, if you want Marcus Fenix in his armor, you know, to use as a character in Horde or in multiplayer, then you have to buy booster packs. But he's a legendary character, which means that he probably has maybe about a 3% chance of unlocking. Now, with that being said, say you get, and I'm going to make up one. Let's say that you have JD in a Hawaiian shirt. Let's say there's a JD in a Hawaiian shirt as a costume. That could be a common. Okay, that could be a common card. So that means that you've ended up getting JD as a costume to use in the Horde or the multiplayer in a Hawaiian shirt. Might seem quite nice, might seem quite funny, kind of like a little bit of an Easter egg or something. But through getting that, that then means that you're gonna keep getting that card until you get the Marcus Fenix. But you may never actually get the Marcus Fenix, but you can buy the Marcus Fenix card. Now, you can do that by getting scrap, and that is what you do by getting rid of the cards that you already own. So what you'll end up doing is, you will get the multiple JD cards, you'll then grind them down for scrap, which are about 5, I think you get like 5 scrap per dismantled card, and then you can say like buy the card that you want, the costume card, for about let's say about 600 scrap. So if you think how many times you've ended up having to buy that, you know, or sorry, get those booster packs, buy those booster packs, and then dismantle all those cards that you don't want, you get maybe about 4 cards per booster pack, I think, or maybe 5. But you then have to dismantle 5 of those cards, which will give you 5 scrap each. And think how many times you have to then play the game to even be able to buy those booster packs. So you have to buy the currency to buy the booster pack, just so then you can dismantle the cards within the booster pack to get the costumes and the, you know, other like beneficial cards that you want. That is shocking, knowing that there is that kind of like currency system in the game where you have two forms of currency system, two layers to actually getting what you want in this game. And like after playing like 4 to 5 horde modes of the same thing over and over again in these very close like maps. These maps are actually smaller than the original horde maps as well. But after playing these maps, I was done. Like, I could not do that over and over again with so little content when it comes to the horde and stuff. And then having to have that grind system. Like, why put a grind system in Gears of War? The game does not even have that much longevity when it comes to actually playing it. Like, you can maybe play like a match or two before you're done for the day. But having to do that every single day and coming back and trying to solve it is just so frustrating, and they should not have done that. And it's just ruined it for me, because one of my go-to modes was Horde mode, and you can't play Horde mode now. Like, there's just not enough for you to come back and try and enjoy it. It just feels too grindy. It just feels way too grindy. You get too little resource when it comes to buying those packs, when it comes to Horde mode and multiplayer, and they just needed to do more with it. They needed to give you way, way more. Just reward you. It feels like they're saying, oh, you want this? Then you put the work in. You know, we put the work in to give you this game, which feels like very little work, to be honest. Like, obviously, I respect what they've built. Like, obviously, these are brand new maps. These are brand new characters. But the enemies are just replaced templates. You know, don't fool me with that kind of stuff. And so it just sucks. It's just a massive shame that they've ended up doing that. And I hope that they fix it. I hope they listen to the community, because a lot of the community are complaining about, you know, everything that is wrong with Gears of War 4. And it's just a shame to see the multiplayer do that. It's a shame as well to see the multiplayer become, you know, so samey instead of being such a, like, vibrant, like, package of variety. Like, we saw so much variety in, like, Gears of War 3 and Gears of War 2, and you had Beast Mode, which was a really cool kind of, like, what would you say, like, flip of Horde Mode, where you actually played as the Locust attacking, you know, the Gears trying to survive. So it was kind of like Left 4 Dead's Versus Mode, where you had two sides, one was playing as the Special Infected, the other people were playing as the survivors trying to get through the map. And so you had that kind of thing in it, but they haven't put that in it either, so there's even less content. They didn't build up on that. And so you don't have the Beast Mode, you have an actual lacking Horde Mode, which doesn't feel like Horde 3.0. It's more, I would say, Horde 1.5, it's actually going backwards. It's kind of like, it feels like it's leading up to Horde 2.0, which just seems odd. Don't you think that sounds odd? I think that sounds odd. And the other thing that they've ended up doing, as you may notice here, is there's the enemy times 2 health, and there's the enemy times damage and things, is that they've even put more difficulty strain on the Horde mode as well. So even if you play normal, it's actually a lot harder now to solo and actually just play casually by yourself. They want you to actually play with the community, which I understand, I get it. You want to, like, have your gamers play in the multiplayer kind of environment, but like, I love playing by myself. I love kind of like being in my mech, like Silverback in Gears of War 3, all, you know, on my lonesome and stuff. But they actually, and we're already only at wave 24, and they've already shoved in, I think it's at like wave 5 to 10 that they put health times 2 on enemies. And if you've seen the damage output of some of these guns, it's stupidly low. They obviously want you to play so much through those beginning waves, and to like get a community, like group together to actually like try and defeat these things, so then you can get more card packs and stuff. It's just daft. And there, look, I was shooting an invisible wall with my rocket launcher. There's just so many weird things wrong with this, and I just don't know what to think anymore. So what I'm gonna end up doing is I'm gonna end up reviewing the last bit of the campaign that I'm playing through, because I ended up just quitting the Let's Play. It gets so boring. I didn't want to force myself to try and play a game that I just wasn't enjoying when it comes to actually like expressing my opinion of it, because like, you want to play a game and like have a nice kind of, you know, thought about it when you're playing it, not complaining about it. And I was complaining about it a bit too much. It was kind of like when I played SpongeBob, was it called The Revenge of Plankton or whatever? Like, that game was bad as well. And so, wasn't it like by the end, I was just like completely miserable. I was like on the verge of suicide, like in game. Like, I was gonna just keep throwing SpongeBob off a cliff at a certain point, I think. And so it kind of feels like, it's funny to actually like compare Gears of War 4 to a SpongeBob game in the level of annoyance of its repetitivity and also the lack of content. And so I'd love to know your opinion though. Comment section below, let me know, what do you actually think to Gears of War? I would love to know. I mean, this has been taken on by a different developer. This is not Epic. So obviously Epic made all the other games, and the other games were really, really good, apart from Judgment. I don't believe Judgment was made by Epic. But, you know, like, Gears of War 1 to 3 were really good games, really solid games, and we expect that from Epic Games. You know, they've made some fantastic stuff. They're also working on, at the moment, Paragon, which is an amazing MMO. Sorry, an MMO. Is it an MMO? It's not an MMO. It's a MOBA, I apologize. And I'm addicted to that game. I love Epic's, you know, Paragon MOBA. It's a really, really awesome game, and I highly recommend it. But I would love to know what you think to this, because obviously this is kind of like Gears of, not Gears of War 5, it's like Halo 5 that was taken on by 343 Industries, which was a brand new developer focused on making Halo games. They did Halo 5 and it actually didn't do very well. It was actually terrible. It was a forced sequel. And what we're seeing right now with a brand new developer made under Microsoft for Gears of War 4 is, you know, that same thing. It feels forced, and I don't want to see that for these exclusive franchises. You don't see Sony doing that. You don't see that on Uncharted and stuff. Like, they've ended up, like, respecting Naughty Dog and saying, look, if you don't want to make any more Uncharted, you've done a fantastic run of Uncharted, but you want to make better things. They understand that their developers want to make more better, awesome things, like The Last of Us and stuff. But either way, it's been me, Josh, bringing you some Gears of War 4 and my opinion on it. I would love to know what your opinion of it is, though. Just wanted to ramble for, like, 20 minutes. I would love to know your opinion, though. And I'll see you all next time, and I'll also see you in the Gears of War 4 review. Hopefully it's better than what I'm saying right now, because I haven't finished campaign yet, but looking forward to reviewing it for you. Ciao for now.